Good evening. If we could settle in and get ready for tonight's service. Just a reminder once again, if you have a cell phone, if you could silence it or turn it off so it doesn't disturb tonight's message. And if we could bow for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for another night where we can gather together here in peace and safety, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, for all the blessings you've given us. We thank you for sending your son Jesus to die on the cross so that through faith in him we can have a healed relationship with you and a home in heaven guaranteed. We thank you for preserving your word. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for your grace and mercy, which is renewed every day. We thank you for our pastor. We thank you for the brethren, Lord, the deacons, the elders, and the faithful servants here, Lord, and all those that come and support the word. We pray, Father, you bless the message tonight. Pray you just bless Pastor John as he brings it forth. We pray, Lord, that our hearts will be open to receive it, Lord, that it will fall on good ground. We pray all these things that it will bring glory and honor to your son, Jesus, Lord. In his name we pray. Amen. If we could stand and praise the Lord.
Fly away. Fly away. roots are strong and storm. What heights are there, what depths are these? When fears are still, when striving seems, my comforter, my all in all. Here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, the true one flesh, fullness of God in helpless pain. This gift of love, where the righteous dance, is gone by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, that's Jesus' life, the wrath of God was satisfied.
We have one announcement. This coming Friday will be our old-fashioned tent revival Bible study at Paris Irons Farm. The gates open at 6:30. The service will start at 7. We encourage you to invite all your friends, family, anyone you like, and there'll be a toast of marshmallows afterwards and perhaps some other activities. So look forward to that. Also, with that said, teachers and children could be dismissed to class. And now it's my honor and privilege tonight to introduce our pastor, Pastor John Ritchie.
Thanks, buddy. Hey, man. How's everybody doing tonight? You know, it's awesome to be able to just sing these great old songs and new songs. Those lyrics are just so powerful and inspiring, aren't they? Amen. All right, let's take our Bibles and turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, and we're going to begin there in a moment. We're going to have a word of prayer. If we could bow our heads. Father, tonight we're so grateful and thankful to have this time to gather together again around the Word of God with the people of God to the name of our risen Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. I do pray tonight that you would challenge our hearts, Lord, through the things we're about to note and study, that we could continue to grow as disciples of the Lord Jesus. I pray that you prepare us for the battle and for the warfare against Satan and his minions and his lies and deceits in this devil's world. And I pray if there be anyone tonight that is unsaved, I pray that you touch their heart and convict them of their sin, that they might believe upon the Lord Jesus and be saved. And I pray for the service on Friday, Lord, I pray that you would pour out your Holy Spirit, Lord, with power and conviction. I pray that you bring in the unsaved and the unchurched, that those that are lost may hear the gospel, and that those who are looking for a church may find a home among us. Now I pray that I could speak your word with wisdom and grace, conviction and passion, humility, and the authority that your word deserves. And I pray that I could take the knowledge you've given me on this subject, make it clear and accurate and understandable, that your people may be blessed. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And amen. We're going to continue tonight looking at, under the conflict of the ages, Satan's offensive strategy, his attack on the gospel of grace. And the gospel of grace in the day and age that we live in is under great attack. And the amazing thing about it is this attack is not coming from outside the church, is coming right within the church, in the apostasy that is going on in supposed, quote, Bible-believing churches, where there is much legalism and false teaching of lordship salvation, or lousia salvation, which basically amounts to work salvation and a denial of the grace of God. Part of Satan's offensive strategy is to blind the unbeliever from the truth of the gospel. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 3 and 4. We read, "But if our gospel be hid," if it's hidden, "it is hid to them that are lost. The lost are blinded to the gospel until they come to the point where they humbly and honestly admit that they're a sinner in need under the conviction of the Spirit, in whom the God of this world," and that's a reference to Satan because this is his world right now. If you haven't noticed, just watch the evening news or read the newspaper. He controls this world system. "And he hath blinded the minds of them which believe not." There's a satanically imposed blindness on the mind of the lost. That's why it requires not just giving them accurate information about the gospel, but it requires prayer so that the Holy Spirit will convict them of their sin and lift that satanic blindness, that they may believe the gospel. And it says, which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. So this satanically imposed blindness keeps the truth of the gospel of grace hidden to those that are lost. But the thing about this is, many of these people who are lost fill the pews in churches all across this country and around the world. But they are subject to hear another gospel. They are hearing not the gospel of the pure grace of God through faith alone in Christ alone. They are hearing, believe in Jesus plus something what? Else. And that is another gospel, and it amounts to simply what? A gospel of works. And this blindness to grace is imposed by who? Satan. I talk to folks all the time from other churches, and they use the same kind of language we do, the same vocabulary, but they do not understand what grace means. To them, is grace is God giving you a little help along the way. They don't understand that grace is the principle by which God saves men completely and freely through simple faith. And that once this salvation is received, it's permanent and forever. And that once you're in God's grace, you stand in His grace, and He's always going to treat you with grace. Because grace is all that God is free to do for man because of what? The cross. It's His unmerited favor, freely given. God desires that all men should be saved. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4. This is also being denied in the churches today. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse number 4 tells us, He will have all men, and all men means what? All men, to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth, to come to that saving knowledge of the truth, to come to that belief in the truth about Jesus Christ, the Savior. God desires, He wills that all should be saved. And this is being denied in the churches because of Calvinism today, which is gaining great, great popularity and inroads in the seminaries, which are pretty much taken over by Calvinist professors and are producing Calvinist ministers who deny that Jesus Christ died for all men and teach what they call limited atonement, that Christ only died for an elect few. And not only do they only believe that He died for an elect few, they believe that it's only His will to save an elect few. And those who produce faith plus what? A life of works and holiness, these are the elect or the predestined. This is a false gospel. This is part of the satanic blindness to the grace of God. Satan blinds the lost to the pure grace of God, that Christ has finished the work and we're saved by simply believing on Him, believing the propositions that the Scripture sets forth, that He is the Son of God who rose again from the dead, who guarantees eternal life to everyone who simply believes. Okay? And Satan blinds men to this great truth, and he uses another gospel where the name of Jesus is mentioned, and much of the vocabulary that you and I use is mentioned, and a lot of the scriptures that we read and quote are used and mentioned, but it's not rightly divided according to the grace of God. And what this amounts to is a satanically imposed what? Blindness, because in the last days many would depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of what? Devils. Listen, the lost are to be saved by grace through simple faith alone in Christ alone. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. Ephesians 2, for by grace are ye saved through faith. And that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And of course they say, yes, we believe in salvation by grace. We believe it's by grace through faith. And then they redefine faith. It becomes a matter of semantics. Faith is not simple conviction of the truth. It's not simple belief in the facts, the propositions that the Bible sets forth about Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who rose again, who guarantees eternal life to those who believe on Him.
Faith now becomes obedience, loyalty, sacrifice. You see? Perseverance till the end in holiness. Faith is redefined to include what? Works. You see? And they say it's a faith that works. That's how they define it. This is another gospel. This is a denial of faith alone in Christ alone. And when you hear these men like MacArthur and Piper and Washer and Ray Comfort and Francis Chan and a host of others who follow in that train, I hope you have the spiritual discernment to recognize, even though they may use the vocabulary that we use in some instances, and even though they may quote the scriptures that we quote in some instances, they do not believe in the simple gospel of the grace of God. They are denying the gospel of grace by redefining what faith is and turning salvation by grace through faith into salvation by grace through faith that works. And they add works to what? The gospel of grace. And guess who's behind that? Satan. How diabolical Satan is that he can get into the churches, and not just into the Bible-denying churches and the liberal churches and the Catholic churches, because they always had it wrong, and pretty much Christians could figure that out. But he can actually, not just the cults like the Jehovah's Witnesses and the Mormons, because Christians could figure it out if they grew a little and read the scriptures. He has actually gotten into what were once good Bible churches. He's gotten right into the pulpits and the minds and the hearts of prominent men who have a great influence upon Christianity through book sales, television, radio, tapes, conferences, etc., and so on. It has now corrupted the church from within. Satan has ministers in the church under demon influence, save men who have now become the servants of Satan. Because at one time they proclaimed truth, but now they are proclaiming another gospel by adding to faith alone in Christ alone. Let's put our first principle up on the board quickly. Satan blinds the unbeliever to the message of the gospel of the grace of God and replaces the gospel of the grace of God with religious works salvation. Religion is Satan's ace trump. As I told you last time, Satan loves religion. He doesn't mind people carrying a Bible, going to church, singing hymns, using the name of Jesus, and doing good deeds. As long as they don't understand the gospel of grace and proclaim it. If they're trusting in their own self-righteous works, Satan's fine with that. Our next principle. What is the definition of religion? Understand what religion is. Religion is man by his own morality, works of self-righteousness, and merits, trying to earn an eternal relationship with God. Religion is man by his own practice of works and good deeds and rituals, trying to what? Earn his way into heaven. Satan offers mankind a counterfeit gospel of works in place of the grace of God. And I hope you understand that when you encounter Christians from other churches where they teach you can lose your salvation, or you have to confess your sins to a priest and take sacraments to get salvation, or you need to be baptized to be saved, or you need to live a holy life to prove you really are a Christian, or else you're not one of the chosen, elect, and predestined to be saved, that you realize that you are talking to a, if they are a believer, and if they aren't, they're in real trouble, but you're talking to someone who is under demon influence, who is believing doctrines of devils. And I hope you have that discernment, because maybe God puts you there to confront them with the truth that salvation is by faith alone in Christ alone because of God's grace and unmerited favor. Satan influences religious people in their arrogance. He plays, you know, the whole thing about this is this. Satan plays to mankind's pride. He plays to mankind's own arrogance. We always want to feel that we're a little better than somebody else. We always want to feel there's something we can do to contribute to our salvation. And the truth is, when we come to Christ, we come empty-handed. Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to the cross I cling. Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me. O Lamb of God, I come. We come empty-handed with nothing except one plea. Jesus is the Savior who shed his blood and rose again. And I believe that, and that's my only hope. And if we have that, we have eternal life. We have everything. No amens on that one. It's been a tough week so far. Now, Isaiah 64, 6. Satan loves to play to human beings' what? Religious pride, their self-righteousness, that holier-than-thou streak that human beings have in them. You see? And a religious person cannot be saved until they recognize that their religion is nothing but filthy rags. Do you hear me? Religious people cannot be saved until they recognize that their religion is filthy rags. Do you hear me? Look at Isaiah chapter 64, verse 6. But we are all as an unclean thing. That means every one of us is a sinner. And all our righteousness are as filthy rags. Isaiah just told us that our own goodness, our own righteousness, our own religion, our own religious works and practice of rituals and good deeds is filthy before God. It is filthy. And the word filthy rags in the Hebrew means a woman's menstrual cloth, which was considered an unclean thing, and she was not allowed into the temple for a period of about 7 days, and then she had to go through a cleansing to be allowed back into the temple. And why did God do that? It's a natural thing, yes, but God used it to try to demonstrate a principle. Okay? That when you're unclean, you can't approach him. You need to be cleansed. And of course, the blood of Christ cleanses what? Everyone who believes. But here's the truth. Human beings' own righteousness that they produce through the practice of their religion is nothing but filthy rags. It's rejected by God. Do you realize when Jesus died at the cross, he was not only paying for our sins, he was condemning our righteousness? You know, at the cross, Christ was condemning, in his death, God was condemning all human good that you do or any person does to try to earn God's acceptance. At the cross, God was saying, listen, people, all your righteousness cannot satisfy the demands of my what? Justice and righteousness. The only thing I can accept is what Jesus is doing on this cross. And the cross is the only thing. And he is condemning man's human righteousness as nothing but filthy rags. Wow. And yet people still insist on trying to what? Earn their way to heaven. Try to do some works. Why? Because there's always a part of our flesh that wants to believe we can contribute something. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. I don't wash it away, and I can't pay the price. I can't even contribute 2 cents to it. He paid it what? All. And all to him. That's why he gets all the glory. And then these religious works people, they go on crusades to try to make the world, the devil's world, a better place. Let's stop abortion and pick at the abortion clinics. Let's get politicians that we believe are good and elected to office, and on it goes. Let's solve the problems of the poor, etc., etc., etc.
And they go on these crusades to try to make a world a better place. All they're doing is helping the devil fulfill his plan. Our next principle, let's keep moving. Satan uses false teachers to promote his policy of work salvation of religion. He uses false teachers. Anyone who is adding works to the gospel of grace is under the influence of what? Demons. They are cooperating with Satan in his policy of promoting works religion. Mark chapter 7, verses 6 to 9, quickly. Let's read it. Jesus speaking to the Pharisees, he answered and said unto them, well hath Esaias or Isaiah the prophesied of you hypocrites. He called them hypocrites. He was speaking to the Pharisees, who were very religious people. Why did Jesus call the Pharisees hypocrites? Weren't they very religious? Weren't they very sincere? Yes, but here's the problem. Religious people can be very sincere, okay, and very moral. But they are hypocrites because they are trusting their own righteousness and their own goodness and their own religion to get them to heaven, and they are rejecting the grace of God in the cross of Christ. They're trampling on the blood of Christ. Therefore, they are hypocrites. And then he says, as it is written, this, you gotta get me back here. This people honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. They can sing his praises, they can talk all kinds of spiritual stuff, but if they are depending on their own righteousness, they're hypocrites. Howbeit in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. For laying aside the commandment of God, ye hold the tradition of men, as the washing of pots and cups and many other such things ye do. Verse 9. And he said unto them, full well ye reject the commandment of God, that you may keep your own tradition. Religious tradition is one of Satan's ingenious what? Tactics. I was raised Roman Catholic. From the time you're this high, you're indoctrinated. You're a little whippersnapper, and they dress you all up and they say, oh, you get your first communion today. And they throw you a big party and people give you money. Oh, this is great. I like my religion. Go buy some toys tomorrow, some goodies. You see, then it goes a little further, and you get your confirmation, and they do the same thing. They dress you all up, and they make a bigger deal out of it. And there's more pomp and more circumstance. The bishop comes down, you kiss his ring, he puts his hands on you, you feel special. And they come and have a party, and they give you more money in envelopes or gifts. I say, this is really cool. And it goes on, next thing is, the sacrament of marriage, hopefully in between you take the sacrament of penance, and absolution, priestly absolution. Hey, you mess up all week long, you screw up all week long, you sin all week long, you go on Saturday, you confess it all. You know what? Sunday, you go to church, you take the wafer, you're clean, you start all over again. It's this constant cycle. The traditions of what? Men. It's not the Word of God. And yet these traditions are taught as if they what? Were the Word of God. Same in fundamentalist churches. There's so many, supposed Bible-believing churches that have created their own what? Traditions that people have to follow. And if you don't follow them, you're not quite the Christian you should be, or you might not even be a Christian. If you don't dot all your I's and cross all your T's like they say you should. Women should dress a certain way. Men should dress a certain way. Your hair should only be a certain length. Women can't wear lipstick. You can't watch this kind of programming or listen to that kind of music. You can't have a glass of wine or beer. God forbid you split hell wide open. We're not promoting drinking because there's some people who should never take a drink. Okay? Because they got a problem with it. All right? And on and on and on and on it goes. If you don't tithe 10%, you're robbing God. Make you feel guilty. Guilt the money out of you. And on it goes. Okay. The Pharisees had done this. They had taken the Word of God and they had added the interpretations of the rabbis. The rabbis started writing down what they thought the scriptures meant. Okay, like commentaries. And then they took these commentaries and over the centuries they started teaching that the interpretations of the rabbis, the traditions of the Jewish elders, were just as authoritative as what? Genesis, Exodus, Numbers, Leviticus, the Word, right? You see?
And now the tradition was on par with what? The Bible. It was simply what? The teachings of men. Religious tradition. Taught as if it was the command of God. And God forbid if you broke it, they'll have your head. You know? And this is why they hated Jesus, because he was exposing all this and trampling all over their religious tradition, and on top of it, calling them what? Hypocrites. He was ruining the party for them. Go to Colossians chapter 2. Who's behind all this? Satan. Remember his table of organization? He has millions and millions. Fallen angels and demon spirits doing his bidding all across the world, assigned to certain areas. There's fallen angels and demon spirits assigned to Woonsocket, Rhode Island. Okay? And we stand here in the midst of all that, surrounded by the elect angels, a light in the darkness to proclaim the truth of the gospel of the grace of God. That the blood of Christ and the blood of Christ alone saves through simple what? Faith. Every poor sinner who will simply what? Believe. Colossians 2, look at verse 16. Paul admonishes the Colossians and us. Let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of a holy day or of a new moon or of the Sabbath days. In other words, don't let anybody judge you in religious what? Tradition and practices. Do you see it? Verse 17, which are a shadow of things to come, but the body is of Christ. Some of those things were commanded in the law, but the law is done away because they were only a what? Shadow. They were supposed to keep the Sabbath under the law, but now Christ is what? Risen. The old covenant's done away. We're not under the law to keep the Sabbath. Christ himself is our Sabbath, right? He's our rest. Let no man beguile you. To beguile means to trick you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping of angels. They had got into Gnostic beliefs. Intruding into those things which he hath not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind. They got into spiritual mysticism. Be careful when you listen to preachers that use a lot of flowery language and a lot of vague terms. That's a way to cover up the fact that they don't know what the hell they're talking about, but they want to sound what? Spiritual, right? And authoritative. Be careful. You know the guys you want to listen to? The guys who aren't so eloquent, but they what? Speak plainly and clearly, and when you're done listening to them, you know, yeah, I know exactly what he was talking about. Don't listen to the guys that after you listen to them for the hour, you say, wow, wasn't that amazing? And they were so dramatic, and they were so eloquent, and they were so charismatic, and they were dynamic. Well, what the hell was he talking about? You have to stay away from those kind of guys with the flowery speech. The Bible says he spoke plainly, and the common man heard him what? Gladly, right? Look at what it says. And holding not the head, who is what? Christ. From which all the body by joints and bands having nourishment ministered and knit together increaseth with the increase of God, the building up of the body. Verse 20. Wherefore, if you be dead with Christ from the rudiments of this world, why, as though living in the world, are you subject to ordinances? Verse 21. Touch not, taste not, handle not. In other words, what? Asceticism. Religious asceticism, legalism. You are more holy if you don't do this and don't do that and don't eat this and don't touch that, okay? And the truth of the matter is there are certain things that are sins that you should stay away from, but people create their own ideas of what sin is and create these religious taboos that have nothing to do with Scripture. And asceticism, you know, which is touch not, taste not, or we call it legalism today, that doesn't make anybody acceptable to God. Verse 22, which all are to perish with the using after the commandments and doctrines of what? Men. All these rules, all these religious taboos, all these religious practices are nothing more than the what? The doctrines and traditions of men. It is religion. It is Satan's ace trump. He loves it, and he's what? Deceived and blinded untold tens of millions and millions of people to the truth of the gospel of the simple grace of God. Faith alone in Christ alone. Verse 23, which things have indeed a show of wisdom and will worship and humility and the neglecting of the body, not in any honor to the satisfying of the flesh. In other words, these things, the people who practice them, pride themselves in how what? Religious and holy are they are, how much they sacrifice, how much they do for God, how much they give up for God. Okay? But all it is an appeal to what? The flesh. It is man's dressing up his sinful flesh to look what? Good. And God says it's all what? Filthy rags. He says it looks good. It appears to be like a show of worship, but all it is satisfying what? The flesh, the religious pride of men. Well, I gave up this for Lent, and I give 15% or 10% to the church, and I was baptized by brother pastor so-and-so, who's a famous preacher, and I don't touch liquor, and I don't dance, and I don't listen to country music, etc., 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 you know. And I got a crew cut, and my wife only wears dresses and no lipstick, etc., etc., etc. And this all makes me what? Holier, right? More acceptable. All it is what? It says it's a show of humility, but it's not real humility. Real humility is obedient to what? The Word of God, not the traditions of man's religion. You hearing me? Okay, let's go on. Next principle. Satan attacks the gospel. Next principle. Salvation by grace and salvation by religious works are mutually exclusive. The only thing compatible with grace is faith, because faith is non-meritorious. What is faith, you say? Faith is simply believing the propositions, the biblical propositions about Jesus Christ. People say, what does it mean to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ or to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ? Simple. It means to believe that he is the Son of God, who died for our sins and rose again, and he saves everyone. He's promised to save everyone who believes. He guarantees eternal life to everyone who believes. If you believe those propositions, you're saved. Faith is simply conviction that something is true. Demonstrate it. I could say, whatever your political view is or not, I don't care. This ain't about politics. I could say to you, Donald Trump is the president of the United States. You can either say, yeah, that's true, I believe it, or you don't. Okay? But if you say, yeah, I believe it, you've believed the proposition. You've demonstrated faith. Will that faith save you? No. Faith in Donald Trump can't save you. Okay? Although there's some people who think it can. No, it can't. Okay? But it's faith. And I could say, if we shut all the lights off in here, and I say, you know, if you flip that switch over there, all the lights will come on. You can either say, I believe that proposition, or I what? I don't. If you believe it, you've demonstrated what? Faith, right? Okay? It's just that simple. Here's the thing. Does that kind of faith save? No. It's not faith that saves, it's the object of faith that saves. Now, if we say, do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God who died for your sins and rose again and guarantees to save and give eternal life to everyone who believes? And you say what? I believe it. That faith saves. Because that is faith in a saving proposition. Believing who's president is not a saving proposition. Believing in the light bulbs and the electricity and the wiring and the switches, that's not a saving proposition. But it's still faith. We use faith all the time. Faith is simply the inward conviction that something is true. Biblical faith, saving faith, is saving faith not because of the faith, but because of the object of faith.
The object of faith is the propositions that the Bible declares about who? Christ. That's it. It's who you put the faith in that counts. Put your faith in Buddha, you'll split hell wide open. Put your faith in the Roman Catholic Church and the sacraments, you'll split hell wide open. Put your faith in Joseph Smith and Brigham Young and the Mormon elders, you'll split hell wide open. Put your faith in Jesus and you will be saved. You see? Faith is faith. It's not the faith that counts, it's who you put the faith what in. And this idea that, you know, saving faith is something totally different than normal faith is foolish. The only thing that makes saving faith is the object of the faith. We have faith in certain things all the time. Someone tells us something, makes us a promise, we believe it or we don't. That's faith. We exercise it all the time. You're going to do it tonight when you leave here. You're going to stick the key in the ignition and believe that it's going to start. That's faith. But that can't save you. But when you take faith and put it in the right object, Jesus, that'll save. You getting the picture here? Do you understand this? It's the object of faith that saves. Now notice what we said here. It's by grace. So if it's by grace, it excludes what? Works. Salvation by grace and salvation by works are mutually exclusive. What does it mean, Pastor, when you say mutually exclusive? What it means is this. If salvation is by grace, then it's 100% by grace, 0% by works. It's not, I used to have preachers say stupid stuff like this, and I'd nod my head because I was ignorant too. You know, in the Pentecostal church, they'd say, well, salvation is 95% grace, 5% you what? Holding on. Till the end. Yeah, amen. Why would you amen that? If it's 5%, if it's half of 1,000%, you ain't going to make it. Okay? It's either 100% grace or 100% works. Because here's the thing. The moment you add just one work to the equation, believe in Christ plus just one thing, you have destroyed grace. Grace is no more what? Grace. It's when you say saved by grace, it means that God does 100% of the work and you simply accept it by what? Believing it. And the reason that faith saved is in Christ saves is because faith is non-meritorious. Faith has no what? Merit. That's what it says. The only thing compatible with grace is faith because faith is non-meritorious. Faith is not a work. It is simply being persuaded or convinced that something is true. It's not a work. It's a thought right up here. It's either you're convinced or persuaded something is true. You are, you aren't. That's as simple as it is. It has no merit. It has no merit. It's not doing anything. It's being convinced or persuaded of something. It's simply thinking a positive thought of belief. Look at Romans 11, verse 6. Let's clear this up because Satan is attacking the gospel and he's changing the gospel today. Notice what Paul wrote about salvation. And if by grace, then it is no more of works. Otherwise, grace is no more what? Grace. Do you see it? If salvation is by grace, then it, by that very fact, it excludes what? Works. Right? And if by grace, it is no more of works. Otherwise, grace is no more grace. In other words, if you add just one work, you've nullified what? Grace. It's either 100% grace or nothing. Once you say, oh, it's 99.9% grace and 0.1% works, you've now nullified what? Grace. It's not grace anymore. See it? Otherwise, grace is no more grace. Look at the rest of it. But if it be of works, then it is no more what? Grace. Otherwise, work is no more work. In other words, if you say, well, it's by grace and works, You've destroyed both.
Really, it's just salvation by works then, right?
It's mutually exclusive. Why by faith? Romans 4, verse 16.
Therefore, it is of faith that it might be by what? Grace. Do you see it? The only thing that is compatible with grace is faith. Read that first part of that verse again. Part A. Therefore, it is of faith that it might be by what? Grace, to the end the promise might be sure to all the seed, and not to that only which is of the law, the Jews, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us what? All. Meaning anyone who's a Gentile who believes. So, the promise is by what? Faith, because faith is the only thing that fits or is compatible with what? Grace. That's it. You see it? Faith is non-meritorious. There's no merit in faith. Nothing meritorious about it. In fact, it's the antithesis of works. For by grace are you saved through faith, that not of yourself, it is the gift of God, not of works. Faith is set in the exact opposite contrast to works. You see? It's the antithesis, which means it's the exact what? Opposite. It's against works. You see? God's judgment is upon all these false gospels. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 5. It says, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. Paul in 2 Timothy is talking about there would come a day in the church where people would have a form, an outward what? Form of godliness. They'd still carry a Bible, a watered-down version of the Bible, probably not a King James. They'd still go to church. They'd still sing spiritual songs. They would use the name of Jesus, but they would deny the power thereof. And it says, from such turn away. Stay away from them. Have nothing to do with them. You say, what's the power of God? Romans chapter 1. I didn't have this in the notes, but let's turn there. They have a form of godliness, but they deny the power of God. They deny the power of the gospel. Look at Romans 1 verse 16. Romans 1 verse 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Verse 17. For therein is the righteousness of God. Notice, not the righteousness of what? Man. Right? Not the righteousness of religion, of God. Revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by what? Faith. The power of God is the gospel of the grace of God, that men are saved by faith alone in Christ alone. And when that gospel of pure grace is being denied, it is another gospel. And those that are preaching it, listen, there's churches all across this country that seem to believe all the right things. Jesus, the Trinity, Jesus is God in the flesh, he rose again from the dead. He's coming back. There's a literal heaven. There's a literal hell. Okay? Yet, when it comes to preaching how someone must be saved, they have added to faith alone in Christ alone. They have a form of godliness, but they are denying the power thereof. They are teaching you can lose salvation. They're teaching you must believe in Christ and do something else to be saved. Or they are saying, they're backloading the gospel by saying, oh yeah, you got to believe in Christ, but if you don't live holy, then your faith wasn't what? Genuine. If you didn't live holy enough, your faith wasn't real. And listen, they say you just had head faith, not heart faith. Listen, the Bible knows nothing about a distinction between head faith and heart faith, because heart faith is what? Head faith. As a man thinketh in his what? Heart. As a man believeth in his heart. For with the heart man believeth to righteousness. Where do we believe? Not with this, with this. Okay? The Bible knows nothing about a distinction between head faith and heart faith. When you hear that, it's simply nonsense. Okay? What the Bible does distinguish in of all the time is the difference between belief and unbelief. That's the only distinction it makes. Okay? Saving faith is head faith. It's believing the propositions in your thoughts right here. That it's true. Is everybody with me? So don't let people catch you in that trap. Oh yeah, they just had a head faith. They don't have a heart faith. Listen, the Bible knows no such thing. Okay? All faith is what? Head faith. Okay. We've got about 10 minutes. We're going to tie this together for tonight. So there are those who have the form of godliness, but they're preaching another gospel. They're denying the power of God. Another thing that Satan uses, we'll look at this briefly as we close, and we'll pick up next week with these thoughts. Friday night, I'm going to preach an evangelistic message. It'll be a good one. You really should be there. And you should bring somebody with you. Open your mouth and invite somebody. And maybe if they can't get a ride, maybe you pick them up. The Lord will reward you someday. On Sunday, we're going to be talking about surpassing grace rewards. How are you going to get these surpassing grace rewards? For your what? Works? Inviting people to an evangelistic service, inviting them to church so they can hear the gospel, is a work that the Lord will reward. Because he that winneth souls is what? Wise. Don't be afraid. Open your mouth. Tell somebody. That relative, that friend, that co-worker. Well, the worst they can do is say what? No. So what? Invite somebody to come and hear the gospel. That also means if you can be there and you don't have a good reason not to be, you ought to be. Okay? All right. Because listen, we're going to talk about surpassing grace rewards Sunday. How are you going to start building up these rewards if you don't start doing stuff like that in your life? Yes, the Lord will reward you for being faithful to the church and giving and supporting the church. He absolutely will. But if you want to crowns that the Bible talks about, the exceeding great reward, you got to do a little bit more than just show up. Okay? Showing up is good. Praying for us is good. Giving is good. But you can do a little bit more than that. Jesus said, occupy till I come. Well, I don't know what I could do. Listen, invite somebody. Just invite them. Worst they can do is say no. Okay, let's tie a few things together here tonight. Our next principle, if we could put it up on the board. I'll just quickly mention this and we'll close it up for tonight. Another thing that Satan uses to attack the gospel of grace is religious mysticism. I'll explain this. Satan uses religious mysticism to deceive the unbelieving world. This is also part of his blinding people to the gospel. Satan uses false miracles, apparitions, false prophets who claim visions and supernatural healings as an example of the mysticism of religion. Satan uses religious mysticism
People think because someone claims visions or dreams or supernatural power to heal, or maybe even can manifest some of these things, that somehow that gives credit to their religion. Okay? Somehow that establishes their religion as credible. Well, hey, you know, I went to Medjugorje to pray and Mary appeared. And I saw her. And guess what? There was this little boy there who limped. And guess what? He was healed and he didn't limp anymore. That's got to be of God. Oh, there was this healer that came through. He was down at the Dunk, the Civic Center. And it was 15,000 people there, and the choir was huge, and they were singing gospel songs, and everybody was swaying back and forth, and he had a healing line, and people were coming down to the front. He was laying hands on people, and they were falling all over the place. The Holy Ghost was moving in mighty power. And there were people babbling in other tongues. Gotta be of God. Well, I went to the guru, and he walked on hot coals, and he didn't even burn his feet. And he told me things about my life that were true. Must be of God, godly man. Religious mysticism. The claiming of all kinds of supernatural spiritual phenomena. Okay? Satan loves to lend credibility to false prophets and false teachers by demonstrating. Because listen, one thing you've got to realize, in the spiritual realm, did we not study that Satan has a table of organization? Did we not talk about demon influence? Did we not talk about demon possession? In the spiritual realm, there are two forces at work. Satan and his minions, and God and the holy angels. Everything supernatural is not of God. Satan can do lying signs and wonders. How do you know if it's the truth? Well, if someone is telling you to pray to Mary to get to God, that's of the devil. I don't care how many times she appeared and how many little boys and girls don't limp anymore. Get out of the emotion and get spiritual discernment in here. The Bible says, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father but through me. You can't get there through Mary. It says there's one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, who gave his life as a ransom for what? All. One mediator that eliminates Mary, Buddha, Muhammad, everybody else, the Pope. The priest, you name it. The guru. So I don't care what kind of supernatural phenomena they demonstrate, all these apparitions of Mary are satanic. All these fake healers are either absolute charlatans using the power of suggestion and mesmerism, or they're demonized. How do you know the difference? By their fruit. I mean, by the life they live? No. Well, they're sweet and nice. No, some of them are very nice and very moral. No. The doctrines they teach. What do they teach about Christ? What do they teach about salvation? God is not the author of confusion. You think God's going to give some charismatic Pentecostal fake healer the power to heal people and dream dreams and see visions and prophesy the future, who teaches that you can lose your salvation? Who teaches that Jesus had to be born again in hell to become our Savior? That he didn't suffer enough on the cross? And on and on and on. We've got to get beyond just looking at things. It's called spiritual discernment. And the Bible says, he that is spiritual discerneth what? All things. As you grow, you will grow in spiritual what? Discernment. Let me close. Last verses. 2 Thessalonians, I want to demonstrate this to you. And why is this all so dangerous? It's all so dangerous because Satan has a man that he's going to bring on the scene. The Bible calls him the man of sin, the son of perdition, the beast. We refer to him as the Antichrist. He's going to be a world dictator. He's going to have a religious leader who's going to be the false prophet who's going to promote him, his own personal John the Baptist. He's going to be Satan's seed. He's going to be the counterfeit Christ. The mystery of iniquity to counterfeit the mystery of what? Godliness. God was manifested in the flesh. Satan will be manifested in the flesh. He will be Satan's seed, Satan's son. And he will come with supernatural power to deceive. And if you just think, oh, well, you know, it's supernatural and he's sweet. He's not like that big mouth Richie who teaches truth. He's sweet. He's so loving. He's so nice. He's so gentle and tender. So much like Christ. That's how much you know about Jesus. Woe unto you, scribes, you Pharisees, you hypocrites! You search the world over to make one disciple, and you make him twice the child of hell as your own self. How shall you escape the damnation of hell? You generation of vipers. That's how Jesus cussed, by the way. He didn't use the cuss words we use. He said, what are you talking about? When he called them a generation of vipers, that was like cussing them out. You might not find it that foul, but he was basically telling them, you're as evil and deceitful and disgusting as a whole den full of what? Poisonous snakes. I don't trust you as far as I can throw you. And guess what? That's who you descend from. Your mommy and your poppy, they were poisonous snakes. Your grandparents, they were poisonous snakes. Your ancestry, you're a bunch of poisonous snakes. Starting to get the picture. Think about it. You've got to read the Bible with open eyes, folks. You've got to read the Bible with open eyes. Jesus wasn't cussing. You know what I'm talking about. To them, that was like being what? Cussed out. Now look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and look at verse 7 to 12. For the mystery of iniquity, that's Satan's man, Antichrist, doth already work. Only he who now letteth or allows will let until he be taken out of the way. There's something restraining Antichrist, probably the Holy Spirit. Look at verse 8. And then shall that wicked be revealed. That's the man of sin, Antichrist, the last world dictator, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all what? Power and signs and lying what? Wonders. What does he do? Anybody? What's he doing? Deceiving through what? Signs, wonders, miracles, healings, right? Starting to get it? Think about it, right? And it says, verse 10, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that what? Perish, because they receive not the love of the truth. And who is the truth? Jesus. I am the way, the truth. Okay? That they might be what? Saved. They rejected the truth, Christ. They're lost. And because of that, and for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie. Antichrist, the counterfeit Christ. That they all might be damned who believe not the truth, Jesus Christ, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. Because they rejected the true gospel of the grace of God, they embraced what? Satan's lies. And when they saw the what? And they were religious folks. And when they saw the signs and the wonders and the miracles and the healings, this has got to be Christ. The Bible said he'd come back. He's here. You starting to get the picture? They're going to say Antichrist is the what? Real Christ. Satan's counterfeit of the true. And how are they going to be convinced? Because they rejected the gospel of grace for religion, and they thought that supernatural, spiritual phenomena and mysticism made him credible. Remember, not everything that's supernatural is of what? God. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Father, tonight we're grateful and thankful to have had this time to note and to study these things from your word. I pray that you would indeed challenge our hearts, Lord. Pray that you'd give us wisdom and spiritual discernment, Lord, that we'd not be deceived, nor led astray from the truth as it is in Jesus. And we thank you tonight that through faith, in simple faith in Jesus Christ, we know that we have the forgiveness of sins and eternal life. We dedicate the last moment of the service tonight to anyone here, or anyone within the sound of my voice. If you're not saved, the Bible says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Right now, in the privacy of your own heart and mind, in your own words, you can tell God, I know that I'm a sinner, but I do believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God who died for my sins and rose again. And Lord Jesus, I'm trusting you and you alone as my Savior and my Lord. Let's take a moment of silent prayer. Now, Father, tonight, if your Holy Spirit has spoken to anyone's heart and they have believed upon the Lord Jesus, my prayer is that you would give them assurance that you've forgiven them and saved them. Pray that you would reveal your love to them in a special way. I ask that you lead them back to study your word, that they might grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. As we depart tonight, I pray that you take the written word and make the living word, the Lord Jesus, more real to our hearts and minds. And I ask these things in his name. Amen and amen. Folks, it has been a pleasure. Let me just say this. I want to ask you, from now until Friday, pray that God will send people, the unsaved and the unchurched, that he pour out his spirit to send unsaved and unchurched people to come to that tent meeting to hear the gospel. Pray. Pray that daily, all right? Have a great night. God bless.